Buenos dias.
As Joy mentioned, we do work with literally hundreds and hundreds of partners every year. I can honestly say, and that my partners in crime here will agree, Joy is one of the sharpest, most on the ball of all the partners we have. So we love working with her and the rest of the team here. So we applaud you for all your hard work. What I hope to do is share some with you about Elvis Presley Enterprises and about Elvis and about the Graceland brand. At the same time, share enough different things so that regardless of what you do or where you work or what brand you work on, you can maybe pull some of what we're talking about out and use it. A lot of what we do is online, and we have some folks here from Aristotle who manage our website. Well, you guys wave, Aristotle people right here. They're a great web partner, and they do a phenomenal job for us and have been a partner as long as I've been there, so 10 years I know of, and probably at least three or four before that. Yeah, since 98. So a lot of what you see online is because of their efforts. That one's kind of a little wavy, so this one over here is more clear. We're going to, first of all, I'm going to share with you some of the brand attributes and the way we look at Elvis today. We're going to share some key Elvis fan indicators. A lot of times people will say, you know, who are the Elvis fans now? And so a lot of times what my job is to share with people the facts about who an Elvis fan is, because it may be surprising to you. Also, since this is about a little more conversation, we're going to share with you some of the things, some of the ways that we communicate with people using social networking, using the internet and other tools like that. And then a couple of really fast case studies that I thought you may find interesting. One on Elvis in 1956 and how we use the internet and how we use the Elvis fans to celebrate that. And then also, Elvis impersonators are always a fun, interesting topic, so I want to talk about that a little bit as well. Of course, everybody knows Graceland, everybody knows Elvis Presley, and so that sometimes is both a blessing and a curse, because a lot of times people have in their mind a concrete idea of Elvis Presley and of Graceland, and sometimes it may not be a positive. Usually it is, but sometimes if I'm in New York and trying to present the brand to a 22-year-old media buyer, she may have a perception in her mind of Graceland and of Elvis that I then have to try to explain to her why she's wrong, or he. Elvis has recorded more music than any other artist. He's sold more records than any other artist. Something you may not know that's interesting is more than 40% of his record sales are outside of the United States. So Elvis is also a huge recording artist in countries that he never even dreamed of visiting, countries where he was never able to visit. If you do a Google search of Elvis album cover, you know, you'll go through page after page after page after page and almost never see the same album twice. The other thing that surprises people is that Elvis still charts today. He just was awarded from Sony, I can't remember how many it was, maybe six gold and platinum record awards this past Elvis week, and there's a possibility that there may be more this next Elvis week. So if you have visited Graceland, and I'm curious, how many of you have visited Graceland? So how many of you have not visited Graceland? So there's a number of you who have not visited Graceland. For those of you who have, when you go through the Hall of Gold where all the records are, you see, you know, you're amazed by how many gold records that Elvis and platinum and silver, all the awards he won. Then when you go around to the racquetball building, that's where we put the gold and platinum and all the awards he's won after his death. And we've got every single bit of space now filled up. There are about 12 that still need to be hung, and we're about to get some more. So we're trying to figure out what are we going to do with all these. We've talked about putting them on the ceiling and places like that. So another thing you may not know is that more songs have been written about Elvis than any other artist. You probably can instantly think of, you know, songs you know that have been written about Elvis or Graceland. Of course, there's, you know, the obvious come to mind. But there's over 220 songs that have been written by him or about him, which really speaks to his significance in pop culture. Which brings me to the fact that, you know, you probably all know that Elvis appears everywhere in pop culture. You can't turn on the TV or the radio without having an Elvis sighting, as we call them. But now that you've heard me talk today, I promise you, the next week, Elvis is going to pop up every single place where you go. You're going to say, I cannot believe how many times. I have two daughters, and when they were, one's 11 and one's 13, and when they were very little, they would call me upstairs and say, Dad, he's on TV again, because he would be on every cartoon. You know, it's just amazing where all he shows up. We do not own, as a business, we do not own the master recordings of Elvis singing. Sony owns that, but we own a lot of the publishing of the music. So when, for example, in a movie, like No Strings Attached, they used Elvis music in the movie. So we worked with them on clearing that. When it comes to things like, for example, on a recent Modern Family, there was a whole storyline about the boyfriend was wanting to visit Graceland. In those cases, you know, it's not a business arrangement for us, but it's certainly key to our branding that it is seen as cool and hip, and that everybody wants to go. We've seen a shift in it becoming more of a rock and roll pilgrimage. Everybody has to go to Graceland, and everybody wants to bring their kids to Graceland or their grandkids and have that experience. We recently had a really fun opportunity to have the entire cast of iCarly and Victorious came to Memphis to do some fundraising for St. Jude. And at the same time, they came to Graceland, and we got video. And it's always fun when you work with somebody like these kids who are famous, internationally known celebrities, and they are just giddy about being at Graceland. So those kind of things, we really take advantage of those great opportunities. Usually the people are extremely happy to talk about Elvis and to let us take a picture of them in front of the house. I mean, I would say at least, you know, every week somebody who's in some way a celebrity or famous shows up. And Kevin Kern, who's our director of PR, he works with those kind of opportunities. And then also we'll contact Entertainment Tonight or someone like that and offer them exclusive coverage. We try to maximize that opportunity to really get the word out. The attributes of Graceland, the brand attributes, what we really try to do is work a great deal with the brand attributes. You know, we stay away from words like museum or, you know, anything that sounds like it's a stuffy, you know, experience that kids would not enjoy, which is quite the opposite. We find that kids really love the experience. They love the tour. There's enough music. There's enough that goes on that keeps them really occupied with all of our different exhibits that we have in place, and we change a lot of those up a lot so people can come back. Graceland has really become so iconic on its own that we have to have a whole different branding strategy for Graceland than we do for Elvis. There's a picture there from Lilo and Stitch, the second one on the left down, and you know, just instantly, that's a Disney cartoon. Instantly, it's crazy that people know now. That image is instantly recognizable by pretty much everyone. Kevin is great at coming up with ideas. For example, with the soccer tournament, when America was in the World Cup. See, he's the athlete in the department. When the World Cup was, we wanted to sort of attach Graceland in a way, and so we had a group of soccer kids come up to the house, and they flipped the switch to turn it red, white, and blue. So we turned the house red, white, and blue, and then we serviced the footage out, and it ended up on all the sports, you know, all the coverage. You know, so it just was one more opportunity to get Graceland in the minds of people all over literally all over the world with that one. For Elvis, there are one of the benefits of working with Elvis and working in this brand is that there are so many Elvises that appeal to so many people. When I say Elvis to you, you may think of a sex symbol, you may think of a gospel music singer, you may think of a humble, poor person who worked his way up, you may think of someone who gave away a lot of things, you may think of a favorite movie that you saw with your parents or, you know, with a loved one, and then of course there's always the music. You know, you'll think of something you were doing, you know, to Elvis music. So the brand is so deep and broad that it helps us to be able to have some words that we always use. And we got these brand statements from the fans themselves. We utilize social networking a lot of times to help develop our brand statements. So oftentimes we all proof press releases, and like Joy mentioned, we work with hundreds and hundreds of products and partners, and so we get really tired of always seeing King of Rock and Roll in every press release. You know, you can only say King of Rock and Roll so many times before you need other words. So we try to incorporate a lot of the other brand attributes. Kevin, how many photographs do we have in our photo archive? How many? Around 70,000 photographs of Elvis. When Colonel Parker did his agreements with movies, he made sure that he and Elvis owned all the photographs that were taken behind the scenes. So we have all the photos that were taken behind the scenes in all the movies. One thing we don't have are just an overabundance of personal photographs taken inside the home, because when Elvis was relaxing and off work, he just wanted to relax and be off work. He didn't want to have to pose. You know, so there aren't a whole lot of pictures of Elvis opening Christmas presents or things like that. Some key fan indicators, you know, and I just had this question asked a couple days ago, you know, what are you going to do when the Elvis fans die? Well, it's a good question. Interestingly enough, the Elvis fans are being replaced by new Elvis fans who are younger. So, this is the Q score, which is what advertising agency people use to figure out the value of a celebrity. As you can see, this is compared to 2007 to 2009, and every year we've seen an increase in people claiming Elvis as one of their favorites. So you can see, surprisingly, even ages 18 to 34, a growth in that group of people. So the value and the appreciation of Elvis is growing. Now, how do we make that happen? People ask us often, you know, how do you do that? Once they find out once they get a good idea of how popular Elvis is in a younger demographic, they want to know, how did that happen? And the answer is very simple. We just do everything we can to get Elvis himself in front of people. And the same thing that he did in 1954 is the same thing that he does now. People see, if they see his movie or his music or they experience Elvis, then instant fans are born. You know, I cannot tell you how many situations we've had where people will come to Graceland and be mildly, if even that, interested. And they will go through the tour, and all of us have had that experience where we've taken people through the tour, we've had, you know, meetings with people who were some very important people, and people who, you know, are in entertainment, in news, all kinds of situations. They go through the tour, and I mean, they come back later and tell us, you know what, I'm hooked. And they want to know more. Where can I get this? Where can I get, you know? Kevin actually had an experience with someone who was a reporter who didn't even want his picture taken. And he came back later and said, can we go get that picture taken now in front of the house? You know, because the person was converted. And so we continually convert new fans. This is just to show you that ePoll is another survey that people use to validate the importance of a celebrity. And this is a couple years old, but you can see Elvis is right up there with the president and Oprah, so he must be very popular. We also do all kinds of research in our department to help people understand more about the brand, more about Elvis. What do people who claim to be Elvis fans, what do they buy? What phones do they use? What games do they play? We do a lot of things online. We have over 300 licensees that are working on product every day. So they want to know more about the Elvis fans. We do focus groups. We just did a series of focus groups among kids 21 to 29 years old in Los Angeles, Atlanta, and Chicago. And we put a bunch of kids around a table, and we didn't tell them who they were there for. They were told that it was a male entertainer, and they wanted to ask them questions. Now, you could really tell at first. I mean, they were really engaged, and they said, someone, you know, is behind the glass. You cannot see them, but they're, you know, so people just knew Justin Timberlake was behind the glass, or maybe Justin Bieber. You know, it wasn't. It was me. So they were a little disappointed at that, but we did get some great research. Once we got into the surveys, you know, they didn't ask leading questions. They just wanted to find out what they thought. And a surprising number of the kids I was looking to see if it's on there. They had Elvis music on their iPod. They wanted to go to Graceland. 100% awareness. 100% awareness of Graceland, which it was really interesting. What came out of that we discovered was that almost there was only one person who discovered it from their parent. Everybody else had discovered Elvis through a choir leader, a band director, someone in their school, and it was around fourth to sixth grade is when they were really remembered, is when they could remember learning about Elvis. So we've really, you know, increased the amount of outreach to people who are educators. All teachers now can tour Graceland for free. You just have to show your school ID. We've done a lot of mailing of things out to people. Before I tell you what we found about their favorite movie and favorite song, I wanted you all to think, what is your favorite movie and favorite song in your head, so you can see how you compare. So everybody have it in their head? Okay, so the movie that's most associated with Elvis, 24% of the people said Blue Hawaii first. And this is from an online survey that we did, and we had 4,000 responses. So you can take that to the bank pretty much with 4,000 responses. 24% said Blue Hawaii, Jailhouse Rock was up there, and with the song most associated is Love Me Tender. So this kind of stuff is really helpful for if you're trying to put together a product program, a t-shirt, a mug, then you want to know these kind of things, and these are the kind of things that we really try to find out about our brand. I don't want to bore you with too many stats, but it is important to note that about 600 people come to Graceland every year from all over the world. And on Facebook, how many of you have a Facebook page? Surely a lot of you. Okay, great. Those of you who don't need to get one. My daughters have 6 grandparents, and all 6 have Facebook pages, and all 6 tell them what to do all day long on Facebook. So Elvis has 4 million friends on Facebook. So it's a really valuable tool that we use when, for example, we announced the Clinton Library. We put that on Elvis's Facebook page, and we'll get 6,000 comments almost instantly. And each one of those people that are commenting, it's showing up on their Facebook page. And so it's making a lot of other people aware through it. It's going viral. Social networking is really, really important for how we put Elvis out there, and you'll see a little more about that now. A little more conversation. This is the top of Elvis.com. If you go home and Google, or don't Google, you can just go to Elvis.com. Aristotle has recently redesigned our page for us, and we've brought it. Our first page, you know, was it's evolved, and then we had to just completely stop down and redo it now so that it's much more contemporary. We have a full-time social networking person. That's all she does all day long, is post things to Elvis.com, to the news section. We have fan clubs that she communicates with. We have an affinity group that people can join called the Elvis Insiders. We have 30,000 of those. So she's constantly shoving information out to all these different people, and then monitoring the responses. So we're not just putting information out, we're also listening to what the fans from all over the world are saying back to us. And we adjust our marketing plan, we adjust our business strategy based on what we're hearing back from the fans and what we're hearing back from people around the world. And we're a very fan-oriented company. What the fans say and do and feel is very important to us. This is the bottom half. What's at the top of the website, we still call Above the Fold, just like it was a newspaper. Below the fold is where we have some ads, and we have links to all of our social networking tools. Our site is really easy to navigate. This is Elvis's Facebook page, and the way that we use the Facebook page, first of all, you can see the, for those of you who have a Facebook page, where your face would go. We actually right now have a promotion on there. So it changes out depending on what we've got going on. If you're not too familiar with Facebook and social networking, then it may not mean very much that Elvis has 4,284,000 or million fans. But it's a huge number, and there are a lot of living, touring celebrities who don't even come close to that number. So it's just remarkable that Elvis has that many eyeballs on his page. The way that this is, these are some good examples of how we use the page. For example, this is a person who got married. We're congratulating them on their marriage. Well, over 6,000 people liked the fact that this couple they don't even know got married. And when they liked it, I don't know how many friends each one of those 6,000 people have, but each one of those people saw that they liked it and were made aware that we do weddings at Graceland. So the comments, you click through the comments, I mean, a lot of times they're just, yay, Elvis, or, you know, they're not really applicable, but every time they make that, somebody else is seeing that and made aware. There's a cool pic of Knollwood Baptist Church Youth Choir from Winston-Salem, North Carolina, performing at Graceland. And so those 2,600 people that liked it made their friends aware that if your Baptist church or your anything church wants to come to Graceland and perform, you are absolutely welcome to bring your stools and your trumpets and your drums and play your heart out. So, and it's a great experience for those kids to be able to go back and say, I played the trumpet at Graceland. And we do really affordable rates for students. It's very important to us that we get as many students and young people as possible at Graceland. Lastly, you know, Elvis is a brand that people like to celebrate a variety of different ways, including purchasing products. So, for example, the Elvis Presley Barbie. There you go. And it's got, she's wearing gold lamé, and she has kind of Elvis jewelry on. Huge, huge success. We've done a lot of different projects with Mattel on Barbie. That's been a huge success. Another one that's been a huge success is the Elvis Mr. Potato Head. We've done, yes, actually, where are my prizes? I'm giving away two Mr. Potato Heads later, so if your business card is not in that box back there, you need to make sure you put it in there. So we use these tools to let people know that this product is available. And Jane, that's her job, is she works with our partners, and she can vouch for when she posts something, people will call her and say, what happened? You know, this all of a sudden we're getting all these phone calls, we're getting all these, you know, all these people wanting to buy stuff. We do e-newsletters. We have around 350,000 people on our e-newsletters. What we try to do is when we send you an e-newsletter, if you're an Elvis fan and you're not on our e-newsletter list, then please go and sign up. But we don't, when we're trying to sell the Elvis cruise, which this newsletter was about, we don't just want you to come sit on the boat alone. We're selling relationships and we're selling friendships. And, you know, people who are Elvis fans will tell you that when they come to Memphis for Elvis Week, they love Elvis and they love the music, but it's also about the people. You know, they love coming, hanging out, seeing the same groups of people. It truly is like a worldwide family reunion every Elvis Week among people who are fans. And there's just something about it that's not like anything else. So, we're selling relationships and friendships, and social networking and people being able to chat has really opened up even more people to be able to meet and talk before they get there, share tips and tricks about coming to Memphis. How do you, you know, where should I visit? Where should I eat barbecue? How can I save money? You know, people really help each other along. Then this is our Elvis Insiders page. If you are an Elvis fan, then you should absolutely be an Elvis Insider. And Elvis Insiders get all kinds of special privileges. One privilege is, and this was big, I had to fight long and hard for this years and years ago. If you are a member, you have access to a live webcam that looks out of Elvis's bedroom window 24 hours a day. So you can see what Elvis would have seen looking out his window all day and all night. And there are a lot of people who will, we also have a webcam at the front of the house, and there's a lot of people all over the world. Our webcam is our number one most visited page because people will arrive at work, and they'll put that webcam on the corner of their computer screen, and then while they're working all day, they can check in on Graceland, see what's going on. They'll see that whenever we have any, we just had the photographer, Annie Leibovitz, was just there taking pictures, and people were saying, who is that? What's going on? There was a, we did a commercial for something, and for maybe Elvis Week, and we had a limo that just pulled up. We only needed like a few seconds of a limo pulling up, and we got the shot and it left. And I mean, it was all over the message board. Lisa Marie is there. I saw the, you know, the limousine, you know, and so people watch it. We got an email from someone that said, I've been watching the webcam, and shuttle number 375, the right brake light is out. So, you know, they really, the fans really take care of us, which is very much appreciated. So, lastly, we tweet. And I don't know how many of you are tweeters, but it is definitely an art and a science all on its own. Tweeting is much easier if you're alive. And so we don't want to be disrespectful and tweet as though Elvis were alive. That's just silly. So we tweet sort of behind the scenes things that are going on. You know, we talk about when celebrities come. You know, we do things like that. And we get followed all the time by different celebrities. You know, then we retweet, which means you repost something someone else posted. And so Jackie, who handles our social networking, she will, she's hooked in. So if Elvis is tweeted anywhere, she picks up on it. And so someone tweeted, you know, look, I'm at Graceland, and I just bought this really cool jumbo collector's cup with a Diet Coke in it. And so Jackie retweeted that, and the person freaked out because they said, oh my gosh, Elvis just retweeted me, you know, for my comment. So, you know, we definitely look for ways to use it creatively but still respectfully. If we have an app that you can download. The coolest thing about the app is that you can take, if you have an Elvis sighting anywhere in the world, you can take a picture of it with your app and it comes to us, and then we post it on Elvis.com. So you can go and see all the Elvis sightings that happen. And we get hundreds of those every week. It goes to someone that works in our department, and she then, you know, post the ones that aren't naughty or disrespectful, or, you know, we get some kind of crazy photos from time to time. But these are just, these, I just went and copy and pasted just a few really quick. I mean, they happen all day, all night, TV, you know, in bars. I was in a restaurant in Barcelona, you know, just all day and all night we get these Elvis sightings in. And so it's just a really fun thing. It's a fun way to connect. Really quick case study. Elvis in 1956, we were looking for a way to celebrate the fact that it's the anniversary of Elvis's, you know, breakout year in 1956. There was a lot of great things he did that were first. And so what we did was we had everybody in the world could submit their own artistic rendering of Elvis in 1956. It could be sculpture, painting, a drawing. It could be anything. I wanted to do performance art, but nobody else would let me. So we did not let people submit performance art. And we picked and we used two local museums to scale down to the top 56, our favorite 56, and then we let everybody vote. Everybody around the world could vote on Facebook. So you would vote by, you could only pick one, you could like it. And so I think I put the winner on. That, these are just some of the 56 that we got. And that was the winner. And she did, you know, a great job. She's a talented artist. She won by, you know, way more votes than anybody else. So it wasn't even close. She was definitely the winner. The other nice thing about this is the prize was 56 different items of Elvis merchandise. And so this is what she won. And I mean, by an item of merchandise, a trip to Elvis Week 2011 was won. She won a membership to the Elvis Insiders. But she also won cabins on the Elvis cruise, two tickets to Cirque du Soleil, Viva Elvis in Las Vegas. So these were great prizes. And the other thing that's nice is each of these prizes is clickable. So if you didn't win, you could click on it and go buy it yourself if you wanted it. So, and it took days to pack all this stuff up. And we did it in my office. And I mean, it was just a lot of stuff to try to pack and ship. It was probably more expensive to ship than anything. Okay. Elvis impersonators. Now, I know that person on the right is not Elvis. Now, I'm not sure who that person on the other side is, but, you know, I know who it looks like. I don't know if it's her or not, or if it's an impersonator of Sarah Palin. Elvis impersonators have been around since Elvis was alive, and there's a story, I don't know if it's true or not, but there's a story that Elvis actually went one time just for fun and competed in one they were having at a pizza place in Memphis and lost. Now, he actually told that story to someone else, and so I don't know if it's really true or not, but, you know, Elvis always felt like it was flattering, it was a little embarrassing, but, you know, he did not have a problem with it himself. As the years went by, some of the Elvis impersonators, you know, didn't actually look the way you would want someone to look. They were not always very talented. So our company just sort of stayed away a little bit. I mean, we didn't, you know, go after anybody. We just let them do their thing and we did our thing. Then we decided a few years ago, how can we rope this in, work with these guys, because honestly, they all have great intentions. And they're and more younger and younger and younger guys and girls tried to be Elvis impersonators. They weren't necessarily trying to impersonate Elvis, they were trying to pay tribute. So what we did was we started the Ultimate Elvis Tribute Artist Contest. And fairs, festivals, theaters all over the world will license the rights to hold one of these contests in their own town. So we have them in Japan, we have them in Australia, we have them in China, they're everywhere. And then during Elvis Week, all these guys who've won in their town come to Memphis for the Ultimate Elvis Tribute Artist Contest. And I mean, it's definitely work. I don't want to reveal how much I really enjoy working on that, because they might take it away from me. So just between us, it's terrible work. It's no fun at all. But all 25 of these guys come, and I mean, they are some talented, talented guys. If you go to Elvis.com, you can get to our Elvis Tribute Artist page. All the guys who make it this far put on just an amazing, amazing show. It sells out. Usually it gets close to selling out at the Orpheum. The response to the fans, because everybody's got their own tribute artist that they really like, they really want to win. My daughter came to one a few years ago, and she really had one certain tribute artist that she, for whatever reason, really liked. And she couldn't go to school the next day because she was screaming so loud for him to win. And that is the, I mean, there are times when you cannot even hear. The energy is so loud. And it's really a fun event. But it's also given us a group of guys who've both won the contest and won the preliminaries, who then we can call on for things like the Elvis Cruise. Anything where we need an Elvis tribute artist, it gives us ones that we can send that are guys who we know are gonna represent Elvis well. And it's been a fun part of taking something that could have been a negative and turning it into a really big positive for Elvis. I'm going to show you like a really short clip that is what we show when we're trying. It's a video that we show when we're trying to explain to somebody just the power of the brand. I don't like to show it first because it's got a lot of Elvis in it and you never want to follow Elvis. Just trust me on that. So we're going to show this and then we'll have some time for some questions and then we have to leave time to be able to give away our Elvis potato heads. To anybody who wants to put their name in that box back there.
With the king, Elvis Presley on a new.
Elvis Presley fan.
With Elvis Presley.
American Idol, Elvis Presley.
Elvis and Presley's bracelet.
The Elvis Presley Christmas tree
with Elvis.
The Elvis cards.
I am an Elvis fan.
There was like an Elvis opportunity.
With Elvis Presley for over 30 years and...
You don't have to be an Elvis fan to just realize he was the king.
An Elvis cruise to the Bahamas.
You like Elvis Presley? Yeah.
There you have it, the Elvis show.
I've been a fan of Elvis since before I can remember.
He's kind of an inspiration, starting from nothing and coming up from what he is.
Well, she's my baby, love me. Well, I found a new place to dwell.
He went out there and it was the most natural, visceral thing that's ever come across in rock and roll.
Elvis Presley was able to do things that haven't been able to be duplicated to this day.
I think Elvis is cool. I just really
sexy.
Do.
Sexy.
Girls like Elvis because he's sexy.
Yeah, yes, cool. He's so dreamy. All of his music, just everything that it stands for.
I don't know if he even consciously knew he was being so sexy. He just couldn't help himself.
Elvis was never short of any stage presence.
Thank you.
You couldn't help but to be entertained by what he was doing on stage, and he drew people in. You know, definitely, he had that look that he looked like a star.
I'm from Spain, and I love Elvis.
He changes into Elvis.
Yeah, makes me want to shake my leg.
Ooh, I feel my temperature rise. Tell me I'm flaming. I must be 109. Yeah.
It was insane, the charisma he had.
I'm all shook up.
I've never seen anything like it to this day.
Out there in the dark.
Because he's the king of rock and roll and always will be.
Look and listen, baby. That's my philosophy. It's called up and back and baby.
love Elvis. I just love him. He's the best. The epitome of cool. The image, just everything about him is cool.
He's special. Elvis is special because there's no one like him.
Terrible to play that and then go, hi, I am Scott Williams from Elvis Presley Enterprises. We have a few minutes for questions. Does anybody have one?
1 second, Brandon, let's get a microphone for you. It's coming behind you.
Thank you for coming. Having been to Graceland, I know you said that you had over 70,000 photos, and I know you have so many personal items. You can't possibly exhibit them all at one time. Mm-hmm. Do you rotate exhibits, and what do you do with all the stuff that's not on exhibit at the time?
Sure.
How do you store it?
There are there's a large archives department, and they are all trained, and they have, you know, they know how to maintain things for eternity. And we have several warehouses that also contain the things that maybe not be quite as precious as the photographs and things like that. The house itself is maintained as it was then. Nothing's changed. It is as it was before. But there are spaces across the street where there are all kinds of rotating exhibits. Right now, we have one that we just partnered with the museum in Washington, D.C. on Elvis and the News. And that has now traveled here, and that's across the street. We have another one on Elvis and fashion that's new that we use a lot of the different things. So it gives us, you're right, it gives us a great opportunity. The Presleys never threw anything away from the very beginning. Vernon saved every single scrap of paper. So you can find, you can take a jumpsuit, you can find the drawing that the designer did. You can find the scraps of material. You can find Elvis's notes circling what he liked and didn't like. You can find the receipts, the invoice, the check it was paid for with, all, and you can put that on display. So every single item is filed away. Interestingly, they do still, they don't want to handle things a lot, so there are things that they are opening as they're ready to catalog. So they're still discovering things all the time. They recently, they were cataloging items in a wallet that they had not opened, and it contained, you know, they opened it and then they scan it and they're going to put it away in storage, but it contained all the things that that you would think would be in someone's wallet. There were photographs of Lisa Marie that were, you know, like Olin Mills looking photos that were in there. There were a gas card his SAG card, you know, just things like that that people carry around, a note with a phone number on it, you know, things like that. So, yeah, I mean, we're still discovering things, and we do still, you know, file all that away. Yes.
A couple of years ago, I saw a show. It was an interview of Ray Walker talking about Elvis and his singing of gospel music. Are y'all still getting gold records or any kind of records that are gospel in addition to pop?
Oh, sure. I mean, a lot of times the compilations will chart when you put together a lot of his gospel music. A lot of people don't know that Elvis's three Grammys were for gospel music. I actually, in Memphis, was for a long time a member of First Assembly of God Church, and that's where Elvis went. And so, you know, church and gospel music, all that was very important to Elvis. And the people who, you know, my friends and peers, their moms and dads were the ones who sang in the choir when they would see Elvis slip into the balcony. He had one seat that he would always go sit at. And they tried to be, you know, cool about it, but it still would create such a response that he, you know, ended up, you know, not going anymore just because of the response it would create and the distraction. But yeah, the gospel music was really important. Elvis loved gospel singers, and so that's why he filled up his stage in Las Vegas with, you know, the Imperials, the Stamps, the Sweet Inspirations. You know, he loved that kind of music, and that's what he listened to when he listened to music on his own, and that's what he played at his piano when he, or his guitar, when he would be in his house just messing around.
Yes, ma'am.
Over here.
How do you source products for what you sell, either on the internet or at the gift shop or anything like that? Or do people approach you, or what's
sure.
the process for that?
There are licensees who our licensing department has a procedure by which they evaluate. So if you owned a company that made lunchboxes, you would come to EPE and say, I want a license to put Elvis on a lunchbox, and I'll give you X percentage of all my sales. And so we're fortunate that we're able to work with usually the biggest and the best of each category. We would give you an exclusive. So the people who fill the stores up across the street buy from those people, but then also they do source their own stuff that's, you know, produced in China and other places like that. And there are vendors who they use to buy other kinds of product that's more tourist related. Obviously, in other parts of the world, a Graceland t-shirt is not as popular as at Graceland. So, okay, right here.
How do you think Elvis would have felt towards the Cirque du Soleil arrangements of his music?
Sure, that's a great question. We just did a comic book, or not a comic book, but a book with graphic illustrations is gonna come out. There was an article about it in USA Today, and the reporter had asked me, what would Elvis think about this book? And what I told him is what we always say is, we don't ever, as a company or as individuals, we don't ever try to think or put or claim to know what Elvis necessarily would have thought about any given subject, because it's just sort of a tangled, you know, web you would get into. Because ultimately, it's really what I think Elvis would have thought. So I personally love the Viva Elvis music and the arrangements. I like the remixes. A lot of what you heard in that video we just heard, those were from Viva Elvis. So because I personally like the music, of course I'm going to say, oh, Elvis would love it, you know. So, you know, I can't really address, I think he would like it, but I do. Yes, ma'am.
One second. Sita.
Oh, sure, absolutely. She wanted to know if the Presleys are involved in things like marketing and decisions. And, you know, I mean, they're intelligent people, and they're not going to, you know, they don't want to know, oh, we have too many pink mugs and we need more yellow ones. You know, they don't get to that level. But they absolutely maintain a very personal and very vocal idea of how their father should be represented, how he looks in the public, how things are presented. And if, you know, they definitely can pick up the phone and call the president of our company if they see anything they don't like or they need more explanation, and they do that, you know. So, yeah, they are very, very involved. Yeah, yes, sir. Either one of you, we'll do. We have time for both.
From a brand standpoint, I was wondering how you deal with the almost contradictory diversity of, you got like, you know, humble and flamboyant and devout and sexual, and
right.
It's almost like a strength and a weakness.
It is absolutely a strength and a weakness. What we try to do, and I have to say this all the time to people who, you know, are unhappy with some aspect of something that we've done, whether it is a Mr. Potato Head or some other something, there will be people who are unhappy. We did a product not too long ago, it's been a couple years ago now, I guess, and I'm not even gonna say what it is, but it was a product that was kind of whimsical and cute in nature. And so the receptionist called and she says, we've got somebody here that you need to come talk to, she's really unhappy. So I said, well, let Kevin talk to her. But she wanted me specifically, so I had to go over there, and she had that thing in her hand, and I mean, she just let me have it. I mean, she did not like that. It was disrespectful. How dare we? And then her sister was standing next to her, and she said, well, you know what? That's mine. She's holding because I love it, and I bought it. So, you know, there are so many different aspects and angles to the brand that we try to have something that everybody can use to celebrate that, whether it's different kinds of music, different kinds of movies. And I always tell people, you know, if the music is what you like, then just buy the music and don't work so hard on depriving other people of something that they may like. You know, I mean, some of the fans will go to the effort to create a website or a Facebook page to protest the creation of an item that they don't like when, you know, I can tell them it's one of the top sellers. You know, if you go to Elvis.com, you can go to Shop Elvis, and you can click on bestsellers. And so you can see what are people buying right now. And it's a challenge when someone's sending you an email and saying, this is a travesty that you allowed this to happen, but at the same time, it's the third most best-selling item for the whole year. You know, so somebody enjoys that aspect. So it's a challenge, and we really take we really consider a lot of the emails. We have unbelievably long discussions on aspects of the brand. And is this a good thing? We analyze everything. We do research. We debate about it. We fight about it. And there are certain people in our company that are a little more conservative and others that are a little more willing to take a little more risk. So we get to what we think is a good place eventually.
We have time for one more if we're going to give away some potato heads.
I just have one kind of, well, actually a two-part question. One is, as you well know, I've come to Graceland many times, and the staff there is very sparse. There's a few people doing an incredible amount of work. Mm-hmm. Would you like to share with the rest of us how many people actually work in corporate, and how many people work in corporate with no sleep during Elvis Week and Birthday Week?
Sure, I can do it in percentages. 100% of the people do Elvis Week without sleep. And you know what? I mean, we can't complain because we all know that we are incredibly blessed and incredibly fortunate to work there. So, you know, when we share that we have a mattress in our closet that we take turns sleeping in, we do so because it's kind of a fun, entertaining kind of thing. We don't do so to complain. But really, I mean, we've gone like, you know, many of us have gone like 36 hours with no sleep. And, you know, then you're trying to deal with thousands of people and media. And so, you know, it gets a little weird. There are during our busiest times of the year, there are about 350 staff members. But then, a lot of those are college kids who are there for the summer. And, you know, when you know the tourism, that part of the tourism season ends, they'll leave. But it's definitely a lot of companies will have to send their staff to go out in the woods and climb a tree and keep each other from falling and, you know, do some kind of work sessions together to keep harmony within their company. We just do Elvis Week together. And then that keeps us, you know, when you have helped somebody haul the trash out, then you have a certain bond that, you know, is more so than other companies. I mean, I've even done an interview about Elvis Week with a USA Today reporter while I'm holding the phone and unloading boxes out of the back of a truck. So, you know, we all jump in and we all haul garbage and we all do it. And so when you come to Elvis Week, that's part of the spirit and the fun. If any of you have not been, you absolutely should come and experience it. Experience the ETA contest. Come to the Candlelight Vigil. If you're really an Elvis fan, you're not an Elvis fan if you haven't been on the Elvis Cruise. There's a brochure in the back about the Elvis Cruise. There are some coupons to go to Graceland. So everybody needs to definitely come and visit us for Elvis Week.